Alrighty, so we're out of the queue. Get a couple of pictures of this. It's an amazing view.
Hey.
Sorry, picture posing there. Humans. Really excited about this. We're going to check out the various aspects of the castle. This is very Assassin's Creed, like very narrow, but in theory climbable. Not there, you have to get a good grip here and there, but visitor information. Shop. Be a nice picture sitting on that rock. I do want to check the shop out eventually. Edinburgh Castle. Memory of Sir. Wait. Hang on.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. Audio guides. Period of at least 2,000 years. Oh, sorry, I was zoomed in. That must have been discombobulating for all of you. Oh, cannons.
We're not going to be able to hear this person.
I am.
Cool. Cannons. Cannons galore. Birth of a king. National treasure.
When you get back down to this area, I know there's one or two questions people would like the answer to. Things like, where are the toilets? Where do they get tea or coffee? Both over here are the red cafe.
On this volcanic rock. This is where Edinburgh started. And over the wall, this is Edinburgh New Town, and they started building the new town around the 1760s. Beyond the town,
love his accent.
You can see the waterway. That's called the Firth of Forth.
The tea room.
Placed back in the gun port, Edinburgh Castle should be able to defend the Queen. The only these are actually naval cannons. These should be on a ship. These guys have never fired from me. Gun. 15mm
gun. I think you said. Oh, I'm zoomed in. Zoom out.
There. But another question he asked is, why 1 o'clock? Why not fire the cannon at 12? 12 o'clock to midday is international pipes all over the world. Well, this is Scotland. And in Scotland, we don't like waste. We certainly don't. And the fire cannon can have 12 rounds of ammunition. And they get at 1 o'clock on like half an hour. And it does exactly the same job. And just leave more money to go and buy whiskey. No chance at all.
The weather here, guys, the weather here is amazing. It feels so good outside right now. Can't even express to you how amazing it is.
We're now going to take a slow walk up the hill, and we're going to stop at the barracks.
Live tour, we just caught the live tour starting. A very large quantity of people. Imagine how much larger this group would be if we had gotten here like a week or two earlier with the military tattoo going. This place would be like shoulder to shoulder. Guards. Edwards. Here we go.
Okay, the building over here, my left, this is our 18th century barrack block. The finished building this in 1799, built to hold 600 soldiers. Today, this is the regimental headquarters for the Royal Regiment of Scotland. In the small door to my left, the regimental museum, and this is the Royal Scot Dragoon Guard. And at one time, this was Scotland's horse mounted regiment. Today, modern warfare, this is now Scotland's tank regiment. Same again, well worth a visit. Small museum over here, and you see it tells us the Royal Scot. The small building in the middle, that's the Royal Scots headquarters, and the Royal Scots, they're one of the oldest infantry regiments in the British Army. They were raised here in Edinburgh Castle under the orders of King Charles I. That was in 1633. And for anyone
1633.
Edinburgh Castle vault and the prisons of war, down the hill, down beside the museum, the vault was 600 years old. During the 18th and 19th century, they were used as prisons of war. Down here, underneath the castle, these vaults could hold 1,000 prisoners. So if you're looking for bed and breakfast, we've got lots of space here. We're now going to head for gate number 7. Looking through, we're at the top of its level. There's no more driving. This way, yeah. Finest food. Okay, folks, you see this small whiskey shop over there? That's actually the old Victorian fire engine shed from the 1880s. So go inside, have a look. You might pick up a bargain. Some of those whiskies only cost £4,000. So I can recommend the shortbread. Yeah. However, this is your lucky day. They're actually doing tasting. So on your way around, go inside, and as we say, try a wee dram of Scotch whiskey, absolutely free, and the more you like it, the more you can try. It's gonna keep you nice and warm, yeah? That was gate number 7. This is the upper ward of Edinburgh Castle. We're now going back to 1314. Right at the time, this King Robert the Bruce, he destroys Edinburgh Castle. That's every building but one. this very special 12th century St. Margaret's Chapel. And that's this small building here. This is the ah. Dedicated to his mother, Queen Margaret. And Margaret was married to Malcolm Canmore, Malcolm III of Scotland. He's a warrior king. He's always away getting into trouble. But Margaret, she's a very pious queen. She's working with the churches, with the homeless, and with the poor people here in Scotland. But in 1093, Malcolm III of Scotland, he gets killed at the Battle of Annan. And it's written in the history books, they tell us, Queen Margaret, being of ill health at this time, that after receiving the news of her husband's death, they say 4 days later, she gave up life. She died with a broken heart. Son David came to power, first thing he did, built a small chapel and it dedicated to his mother. And in 1215, she was made a saint. And that's why today we know this as St. Margaret's Chapel. And this is 900 years old and this is still used. It's actually still used for weddings. These weddings are very, very popular. Especially with the Scots, because this only holds 20 guests. That's good. To the front, one of the best viewpoints in Scotland, looks over the city of Edinburgh all the way to the north. And also to the front, you'll find the mighty Vaughan's men. And this is a huge medieval siege cannon. The cannon weighs 6 tons, and it would take 100 soldiers one day to move the cannon 3 miles. She fires a gunstone or cannonball weighing 330 pounds, and she can fire this for 2 miles. We're now going to walk round into Crown Square. That is the most important part of Edinburgh.
You gotta see this big old cannon thing. There you are. Check that guy out. Huge cannon. 6 tons. Cool.
Just for a quick moment. Okay, folks, just a quick stop. Okay, this is just for information. You see there's a half moon battery here. You see there's a small A board. We're very lucky. We've actually got one of our costume performers, and I do believe he's going to tell the story, very possibly, about the castle being taken in 1314. Now, the first show, I think, is at 11:15. So when we finish, that's the place to go, yeah? There he's there. That's the man over here.
Там везем, то есть каждая.
wind, everybody. The wind is amazing. Ooh.
Okay, folks, just for your information, now that we are at the top of the castle, anyone who requires the washroom, toilet facilities, back between the buildings, you see the railing, the steps go down. Okay, this is Crown Square. This is the most important part of Edinburgh Castle, because it's here we keep the Scottish crown jewels. But in the centuries gone past, in times of trouble, the kings and queens of Scotland, they would come here to be safe. This was the safest castle in Scotland. This was the safest place in the kingdom. The first building in the square, huge building over here, and this is the Scottish National War Memorial. The building dates from the 18th century. It opened in 1927 to commemorate all the Scottish soldiers who were killed in the First World War, 1914 to 1918. However, even today, any Scottish soldier killed in active service anywhere around the world, their names are still being added to the books, and that's within the Hall of Remembrance. That's the newest building in the square. This is the oldest. This is the Great Hall, or the Banqueting Hall. King James IV had this built, and he also had the Great Hall at Stirling Castle built. That was in 1503 to celebrate his marriage to Margaret Tudor. And Margaret Tudor, she was the eldest sister of King Henry VIII of England. And at this time, this is a marriage of convenience. This is when Scotland and England, they are trying to be friends. Even on the pipes, you can see thistles and you see roses. Rose for England and a thistle for Scotland. But we're going to jump to 1650. Oliver Cromwell, he was an English general. He invaded Scotland. He used Edinburgh Castle. This was his military base. And he turned this into the barracks for the soldiers. And it more or less stayed that way right up to the late 19th century. No longer required by the military, the Victorians thought, let's get everything out, see what's left of the original building. And luckily, the huge oak hammer beam ceiling was, and still is, in perfect condition. These huge oak beams, they're over 500 years old. No screws, no nails, no metal. These are perfect joints, hammered together, and they are held with huge wooden pegs. And that ceiling was built by the shipbuilders from the port here in Edinburgh, and it's actually the hull of a ship, and it's upside down. So that's well worth a walk in, well worth a picture. Next building over here, and this is the Queen Anne building, and this is 1710. This was built as the officers' barracks. It was a map-making building. And in fact, today, it's a tea room. So anybody looking for tea or coffee, that's the place to go. But the most important building in the square, this one here, this is the Royal Palace. It has been home of jewels for over 400 years. We see the clock tower. That tells us 1993, that's the year Her Majesty the Queen opened the new Crown Jewel exhibition. Everything that happens in Edinburgh Castle, it gets a date, because eventually this will be part of Edinburgh Castle's history. Small door here to the right hand side, and you see up above 1566. That leads to the bedchamber of Mary, Queen of Scots. And in the right-hand corner of the chamber, you'll find a birthing room. This is where she gave birth to her son, King James VI of Scotland, on June the 19th, 1566. Then, in 1603, on the death of Queen Elizabeth I, he was also crowned James I of England, which actually means that Scotland has ruled over England for the last... Oh, sorry, it's a secret. No. But the most important door in the square, central doorway under the clock tower, this leads to the wonders of Scotland and to the Stone of Destiny. You're going to see a huge glass case. Inside the case, we have the crown, the sword, and the sceptre. This new crown, that was made by the order of King James V, that was in 1540. Now, James V, he was the father of Mary, Queen of Scots. She indeed was the first monarch to be crowned, using her father's new crown. And in 1543, Mary was crowned Queen of Scotland. She was 9 months old. You can see the sceptre, the gold and silver sceptre. This was the power, this was the authority of the King of Scotland. And it was a gift to King James IV from Pope Alexander VI. That was 1494. You can see the sword of state, also a papal gift to King James IV from Pope Julius II, 1507. Now Julius, he was known as the warrior pope, but he was the pope who commissioned Michelangelo to paint the ceiling in the Sistine Chapel in Rome. But the most important thing you will see in the glass case, and indeed Edinburgh Castle today, is a huge block of sandstone. Known to us Scots, it's a stone of Scoon. More commonly known, it's a stone of destiny. This is an ancient Scottish coronation stone. The very first King of Scotland, he was called Kenneth MacAlpin. He was crowned sitting on the stone in the year 843. That was 1,173 years ago. But in 1296, King Edward I of England, Edward Longshanks, he was the hammer of the Scots. He invaded Scotland. He took the stone. This was his war prize. This was his trophy. And he takes the stone down to London, down to Westminster Abbey. He had a coronation chair built in the Abbey. The stone placed into the chair, that was his insult to the Scots. The King of England now sits upon the coronation stone of Scotland. But it stayed in the chair at Westminster Abbey for 700 years. And in 1996, Her Majesty the Queen declared it should come back to Scotland. It is a Scottish relic. So on our patron saint's day, St. Andrew's Day 1996, the stone came back to Scotland. to Edinburgh Castle. However, for any future coronation, that stone still goes back to Westminster. It still goes back into the chair. Because now, no monarch can be crowned king or queen of the United Kingdom without this stone being back in the chair at Westminster Abbey. Only this time, after the coronation, there will be trouble if that stone does not come back here. When in the future back home, you may switch on your television set and there's possibly Prince Charles being crowned king. On that day, you will see that stone in the chair at Westminster Abbey. And on that day, I hope you will remember you were this close to the stone here in Edinburgh Castle. As I've said, each of the buildings you visit inside, you find guides like myself, and we are all here helping any way we can answer any questions you may have. Thank you for taking the time to walk through the castle with me this morning. Your turn to explore. Go inside, enjoy the whiskey. Thank you for your company. Yes.
That was awesome. So, that was a fantastic tour. We're going to look inside some museums. We're going to show you the sandstone, the Stone of Destiny, and all of that. It's going to be good. Which museum should we go in first? Oh, fine. Is it that time?
They're spend the day right here.
I know, I'm so excited. I'm really liking this wind. The wind is fantastic over here. Did you see the ginormous cannon over there? That shoots the 330 pound balls. 1 mile. Let's see what time it is. It's not quite time just yet. These, as was previously mentioned, these are ship cannons.
Through muscle of horse flesh and things like that.
Oh, yeah.
But the Navy also called that rubber cutter. Fired the enemy ring to try to tear
this is the padded armor that was worn
the one
on
the very end. That's a fire basket.
Plate.
Use that for burning castles down.
Many different types of arrows.
That one, the other one, the second one, just for the normal
chain. Fire arrow. Arrows for hamstring horses.
Well, that's the earlier period one. The slightly later the period one is shorter, a little bit thicker.
X is the coif for the helmet, shield, and of course the spear.
Nowadays, the typical one's called a broadhead, but the one there that I said was used for hunting as well as warfare, there's about 7 different varieties of that. It's got a swallowtail. And basically the tails get longer and longer, and the biggest about that across.
Yeah.
Very small head, but very large barbs.
Yeah. Can't get it out. What do you pull it out?
Well, that one, it won't come out, and if you do rip it out, you're tearing a lot of flesh with it.
Yeah, nice stuff.
And archery was so important. When the English army, just before the Battle of Agincourt, they took 3 million arrows.
Jesus. Wow.
3 million arrows.
Oh, wow. And what's this?
That's padded armor.
Really?
It's called a gambeson.
Mm-hmm. So they wore that under the...
Full plate.
Well, 700 years ago, you had the poorer men would wear just padded armor. The wealthier men would wear padded armor and chainmail.
Any armor,
To be honest, the padded armor is just as effective as chainmail. Chainmail will protect you against a cut, a slash, but it won't protect you against a stab or archery. That has protect you against cutting, slashing, stabbing, and that will stop an arrow at about 100 yards.
What's inside of it?
Lots of variety.
That's what's stopping there. And she had leggings and like a maybe a sweatshirt. Huh? Oh. Sure. You can use this. Zoomed all the way out. This is how you zoom in and out.
And just hit the back button for photo.
And this is the button for photo. Okay.
I don't know if it took one or not.
It should say capture.
I think I said scene capture. I don't know how bright it was.
It'll be fine. It'll be fine. Oh, zoom out. You can see all the cool stuff they got here.
When men start wearing a full suit of armor, the mace has spikes on the chest. The scope percussive power and the spikes are clenching.
We've already showcased all of it, so we're good there. You see the different kinds of arrows, how cool that is. You've got on the far left, let me show you something. You've got the fire arrows. The claws and stuff in there. Slide that. The one next to it.
More often than not, the way silk is made, it simply opens up. If you're wearing wools or linens, and you receive an arrow, the arrow might not kill you, but if any of the linen has been pushed into the wound, infection will set in and you'll probably die from it. So silk is very effective. The Mongolian armies, a lot of the Asian armies, and right the way up into the Russian steppes and things like this, on top of the silks, they would start wearing what's called lamellar, which looks like dragon scale armor. Either made out of layers of leather woven together, or layers of steel plates. It doesn't have to be very thick. The metal protects you against the heavy blows, and silk does everything. It also means you can ride a horse, and the horse doesn't have to be a powerful war horse. In Europe, we have to ride destriers, which are almost the Clydesdale. The quick-moving soldiers from Asia, they could wear lighter armor, just as protective. In fact, one of the new armors that are being worn by the Western militaries is called dragon scale armor. It's a modern version of lamellar, so 1,000 years and it's being reused again.
Thank you.
No problem at all.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, in about 3 or 4 minutes' time, I'm going to be giving a short presentation. I'm going to talk a little bit about the Wars of Independence, a little bit about how they're associated with Edinburgh Castle, and I'm going to finish it off by explaining the weapons and possibly dressing someone up as a Scottish soldier. So if you're interested, it's going to be starting here in about 4 or 5 minutes' time.
That would be so cool.
All right. I'm ready to go.
Ready to go to war? I think you're bigger than the average Scottish medieval. Do you want to
watch it? Oh, yeah, he's very good.
Do you want to watch it? Yeah.
I have a lot to see.
Yeah, he's just talking about stuff. So we're gonna.
So this is the first.
As much as I would like to dress up in that armor, as cool as that would be, there's too much to see to warrant sticking around. Unfortunately, I would really like to get a kilt, but they're kind of pricey.
They are.
So
you can go to the Scottish Rite website and order kilts.
Really? How much are they?
I need to be lying if I say it. I don't really know.
Okay. It was not a problem. Just curious. He's from here.
Why did they?
Because it's breezy.
Yeah, really. Why did they wear a kilt?
I don't know. That would have been a good question for our last guy.
Yeah. Maybe we can track him down.
We'll start right here.
You see the Scottish crown jewels? Yeah, we're close here. All right, here we go. Here we go. Going up to see awesomeness. Awesomeness. Oh. Edinburgh. Where's the is there no oh got it. It actually tells you that. Robert the Bruce crowned with a circlet of gold 1306. That is amazing. Some of us are so the Scottish crown changed for the end of the 15th century. A silver coin struck in about 1485 bears a portrait of King James III wearing an arched or imperial crown. Until that time, the crown was an open form without arches. First imperial crown. Founding a dynasty. Dynasty. That is isn't just what you got.
Just a simple sacrifice. forms part of the Scottish Crown.
Alessandro.
There is no proof that this is so, but the circlet of gold begins
to the Bruce. That was the king in William Wallace time frame. According to the film, right. According to the film.
Yes.
This place blows my mind. Scepter and sword came to Scotland as papal gifts to King James IV, 1488 to 1515. Interesting. Italian gentleman. Acolyte. Subdeacon. Bishop Elphinstone of Aberdeen. So it starts out painted and becomes three-dimensional. And the Regis Herald Lyon, King of Arms. Out of Argyle. Master of Socks. No, I'm just kidding. Wow. Receiving the gifts in 1507, King James IV was presented with a new sword. Newman Abbey. That's a big old sword. Craftsman and crown. Is there like a button or something? Can't really see anything. There's a gentleman working the coals with an anvil and hammer. Goldsmith commissioned to fashion the crown in 1539. I wonder if these are just like random facial representations or if they actually mean what they look like. Andrew Lays adding a section of the scepter. Scottish crown jewels. Oh, it's in Braille. How neat and accommodating. Is this so you can feel what the scepter looked like, I guess? The honors were all were with all reverence brought down from the castle, Parliament House, with the guard on horseback to attend them. It's tracking their faces and they're painted. That's really good. Huh?
Liliana,
Well, can't take any pictures of this, so I'll be back in a moment. Back in a moment.